Let me begin the recording. Now it's about 2:10.
Okay, so
All right, folks online, can you hear me? Just want to double check. Hello. All right. Okay, so let's proceed through what we're gonna learn today, which is I think one of the things I haven't really covered is what happened when you use GCC? How does it convert your C files into something you can run, right? And specifically, we'll talk about how Linker works. And how what's the object files? How does it deal with like all the libraries that you can use? For example, standard library, printf, scanf. So here are the general steps. Whenever you are compiling your program, right? From the assignment, what we did so far is we use GCC to process your C code, right? And these Thus far, most of your assignment only have one C code. So you can say GCC something dot C, and then you get the up like dot O files, and literally you can run that and it will work. So what if you have a much more complex infrastructure, like a big program that a company has written, and you need to link them all together? Okay, so internally, when you compile the program, these steps happen. The first step is what we call C preprocessor. And then it would compile. Once you preprocess your C code, it would then compile the C code that are being processed into assembly files. Basically, these are assembly instruction. After the assembly, the compilation step, you assemble basically from the assembly code, you convert to ones and zero. Once you have all the ones and zero, that's where you get the dot o files, right? The dot o files is what you can run. Basically, if you run these binary files, you can actually the computer would run those programs. If you want to link multiple o files together, the last step is linking, which then generate executable, right? So here is what happened in each step. Preprocessor is basically, you might be curious, like what is this .h file, right? So what's .h file that you see so far? What's in there? Anyone notice we have the .h file that in there is just a function name, right? Basically, these are function signature. It tells that, okay, this program will contain these function and these definition, right? So the header files will be processed first to make sure, okay, I know these are all the functions that I would compile. If you have pound define is when you write on the at the top of your program, you write in sorry. Pound define test 10. Basically, every time you came across the word test with the capital letter in your C program, the preprocessor replaced that text with 10. It literally replaced this string with another string. In that case, replace test with 10. This is different from the thing we do to variables like in I equals 10, define test 10 is different from int test 10 in the sense that in this case, test is a variable. It has a value located somewhere in DRAM. Pound define, you don't create a variable, you just replace the text in your program with the letter 10, the value 10. Things like if pound, if not defined, if endef is if this has not been defined, I can the next line I can say pound define. and define another symbol. Basically, this means that if I have multiple files, I'm dealing multiple files, and I am expecting that I need to have this symbol test defined to some certain value. I can check if someone else defined this before in a different C code file or a different header file. If it has been defined before, don't redefine this. Otherwise, define it as this, and it has this value. After you process the header files, so you know these are the functions that you're gonna run, you know that the predefined constant that you just put in there, you replace it in your text in the C code. The next step in the preprocessor is to tokenize your files. This is a little bit more of a compiler discussion, but basically what the GCC do is you go through your code and convert the actual text, like, because basically your program is a bunch of text, like int main, parentheses, open bracket, int I equals 0, b int b equals I plus j. Tokenization means that I'm gonna look through your text and put meaning to the text. For example, if I see things like a equal b plus c, it would actually make sure I token out b and c, and I know that these two numbers have to be added, and then write the result back to a. Put the meaning into the string, parse the string into something meaningful, that's tokenization. These basically prepare your code in C for the compiler to optimize your code and convert that to assembly code, which is the next step. Basically, now that you have all the token process, what the thing you can do is compilation phase happen. You look at the tokens so that you know that, okay, you start with doing an add, followed by a multiply, followed by storing the result into this location in DRAM, followed by return, and you finish your function call. The compilation take this token, convert them to assembly code that you see. And hopefully with some optimization, we'll talk about optimization in a bit. Essentially, the quick way you can make your program faster through some options in GCC. And once you finish compilation, you're gonna get assembly code with the .s file generated. When you run GCC, this is done internally in silent, so you don't see the .s files at the end. This is done while you're compiling, and then it will generate the binary which generated .o files. So when you have the assembly code after compilation, the next step is take the assembly code, convert that to binary. So by this point, you might got sick of our assignment three part B, right? The disassembler, convert binary to assembly. This step is the inverse. So remember our assignment 3B, right? The second part where you take in binary, convert to push instruction. Over here, you see instruction, convert that to binary. It's the inverse of that step. And the idea is basically you check the code. The code would tell what are the bit pattern that you have to put in for each of these instructions. So you would basically convert them to binary so that your computer can understand what they're supposed to do. Binary is a machine language, and you have a machine, you want to run them, so you convert them to binary. After you finish converting to binary, right, you get an object file. Basically, the C, like .c file, the C program, would generate through the compiler, you get the .o file. These are object files. You are now ready to run the program. You're now ready to run the program. What are the potential problems that you can run into? But if you have 10 different C code, you ended up with 10 different object files, right? And this can be bad. Let's say I want to play a game. I install the program. After I install it, I have 10 executable. How can I tell which one do I run? So the last step is to put everything together into one big file. And that's the linking step. And here's a high level overview. When you have a big program, many, many times you would have to compile different C source code into different .o files. The next step is, well, we should combine them together to generate one single executable file that that user can run, right? So you basically, this step is combine this object file into one executable, and here's how it works. You have file A, like file one, file two, file three, .c. The first thing you do with the .c files, well, you compile them, right? You compile them, it generated .o files. Sometimes you have printf, scanf, right, malloc. These are standard library. It's a code that's implemented somewhere in your computer, right? So these library calls, like printf, scanf, they are also being linked together by the linker. The linker basically connects all this .o file together along with all these additional function calls to standard libraries, maths.h, they do random, they do printf, scanf, fread, fwrite, fopen, malloc. All these things get linked together, you generate executable. And then there's also a different version of library. Have anyone here seen the .dll files in Windows before? Like the well, these are another set of libraries, but instead of putting them together in the linker, they get put together when you run the program. So these are called dynamic library. In Windows, these are actually the .dll files. DLL files. Basically, there's a pre-built function that get run when you run the program. So now that we talk about libraries, so this probably the most confusing part, because we haven't really touched them, but you've seen a lot of this. You've seen printf, you've seen standard io.h, you've seen standard library.h, right? So let's actually dive deeper into what do we mean by library. So what's a library? So in a real life scenario, what's a library? What can I use it for? Except for work in groups in silence, you go and borrow books, right? So you go to the library to basically borrow some articles, books, novel, whatever you want to borrow. The same concept apply here. Library of a code that someone implemented, and you can actually run the function in there. Some example is standard io.h, standard library.h, math.h that comes with C. These are called C standard library, and you can actually use them and call the function in there. For example, printf is defined here. And there are many ways you can invoke the library. The first way you can invoke is called static library. This is basically you perform linking the C code along with the library code at compile time. Basically, when you run GCC, the object files that you have along with the library file, anything that you're doing, like printf, whatever, right, you can link them statically, put them into the executable so you can send this .exe file somewhere else. And it would run because every code that you need to run the program is packed into that executable file during the compile time. Basically, during compile time, you have everything. So you can move it, give it to someone else, copy it to a different machine, hopefully with the same setup, and you can run it. So this is static library. The dynamic library is different in the sense that when you compile, you only tell the source, like the executable that, hey, I need this library. When you run it, here's the path to the library. So you know how to run it, but you don't have the source code. The source code comes in when you actually click run, like run your program. That's when you link the library together with your code and actually run the library. So this means that when you run it, you need to make sure library is installed on your machine. that some of the things can happen if you use dynamic library. For example, if you have your own implementation, you can actually generate your own library. One thing you have to do is to make sure computer knows how to load them by making sure the load library path is updated with the path to this library that you're trying to run. If you update that, when you run the program, it will say, okay, I found the library, and it would run the program normally. Otherwise, if it cannot find this library that you want to use, it will say, I don't know what's printf. It would literally say, I don't know how printf is defined. I don't know how to run it, right? So these are some of the things that happen in dynamic library. Anyone want to guess what's the benefit of using dynamic library? Well, one of the common things you do to most of the machine nowadays is you update the machine, right? You can update Windows, you can update GCC, you can update these library. And then if you use dynamic library, basically you can then use the updated version of the library. It means that you decouple your program from the fact that this library has to be updated. If you compile them statically, you got whatever version you have when you compile them. If you use dynamic library, you can update this library afterward, and your program would run with the new library. Right, so there's trade-off here. One is more portable, you can give it to someone else. This one, you can update library, and it's also, this is actually smaller because you don't embed the library code, the library function inside the executable. Aside from this, right, and a few other things that you can run into is something that has the .so files in Linux, for example. These are called share library. What does sharing mean? So sharing means everyone can use it, right? So share library is a library where it's not specific to certain program. Is predefined that every single program can use the share library. Printf, for example, this is a share, everyone can use it. The C standard library, essentially they are shared amongst every program that's written in C. So this basically covers how you link program together, how you utilize the library that you install to your program. And once you have the executable, it means your program can run. Any questions before we go cover how to make your program faster without a lot of effort? All right, so let's cover the next set of topics that I want to cover before we talk about in class 11 and assignment 4. By default, when you call GCC, GCC will compile your code without any optimization. So this is the same as when you put in -o0. -o0, if you put that in as an option, it basically tells the compiler, don't optimize my code. But there are many, many techniques that are already predefined that would go through your code and try to make sure your code run faster. So you can have -o1, o2, and o3. O1 is, yeah, I'm gonna optimize them a little bit. O2 is, I'm gonna be more aggressive. I'm gonna apply whatever O1 apply plus some more. O3 is likely with everything I know and tested that are hopefully not bucky, will be applied to your program, hopefully to make your program really fast. One thing is you can always compile your code with this -o3, for example, likely make your program a lot faster. One quick thing is make sure if you compile with -o3, make sure you don't have like undefined behavior, things like casting problems, like from unsigned to signed. Like if you have a loop and it randomly has this go to instruction in the middle of the loop. So once it hits the go to instruction, it exits the loop and goes somewhere else in your code, right? So these are kind of like not well defined behavior. If your code is normal, like a normal C code, you can use O3 with relatively safety. Like you won't run into weird bugs. If you want to use GDB, sometimes GDB can be slow and big. Like after you compile them, you can use dash OG to optimize the debugging experience based on the optimization flag that added with the dash OG. And if you're curious, here's the basically manual page that I open up, so you can check this out here. So if you go to that link, this is the page that describes best practices. Here's the page that describes how you can put in the options in GCC. So this is really convenient. You can do GCC-03. That's it. It would automatically apply things that are listed here to your code. And magically, well, there are theory behind it that prove there are actual like papers that back it up, that these are going to be correct and faster. And these are the different techniques that you can apply. So over here on this page, you say, okay, if you have dash 01, if you have dash 01, these are the flags that get enabled to your compilation process. For example, if you look at this part, right, it would try to convert if else into something faster. So you can do if conversion. It would try to, what is it? Reorder blocks. What are blocks? Blocks are basically a chunk of code in assembly that doesn't have if, else, or for loop. A straight line code. And reorder blocks means that I'm going to shuffle this thing to make sure after you shuffle it, your program becomes faster. There are many, many techniques in compiler and programming language that allow you to process the code and make sure at the end it's the same exact behavior, but your code looks totally different and it's faster. So if you compile with this O1 flag and you look at your assembly code, you might not recognize your program anymore. So one other thing is, if you want to hack the assembly code, start with dash O0. So make sure you don't apply this thing, but it will change the assembly code. When you have dash O1, O2, and O3, your assembly would change quite a lot. So you might not recognize your program. So it would basically enable all this thing, would convert trees into different structure. So that's dash O1, the least aggressive of all. If you use dash O2, it would apply whatever is in the dash O1 plus these, okay? And you can take a look. For example, if I search for this FIPA-RA, right? In here, it would explain what is that flag? What does it do? They say, okay, when you have the caller set register, when you have this function call, right, when you have function call, what we typically do is you save the register, those push thing that you do before your function call. It would explain, okay, these are the optimization that get applied to hopefully make your program faster. So you can search here, these are the what the flag is supposed to do. There's also things like call or save, which has to do with, again, function call when you create a stack, who is the one who actually have to save the register. So that's the dash 02. Dash 03 is apply everything we've seen so far plus these, right? And you can do things like loop unrolling. Loop unrolling is, for example, you have loop through from I equals 0 to I equals n and n is 100. It would basically do two iterations at the same time or four iterations at the same time. And then you, instead of going to 100, you go to 25. So you, in the end, you are basically doing the exact same operation, but you ended up with fewer instructions. It's like you save some assembly code in the middle. You don't have to increment as much. You can optimize your block better. And these are different optimizations you can do. You can split the loop. You can, I think it's loop interchange as well. So you can check what does it do. So loop interchange is, let's say you have this nested loop like this, I, J, and K. It would switch It might be doing IK and J because it then realized IJ and K is not as cache friendly as doing IK and J. It can detect this thing to measure it out afterward. You hit in the cache a lot more. And the beauty of this is convenient. You just do dash O3 and you're done. You don't have to actually hack your assembly code, and hopefully you get faster code by default, right? So once you actually work in a job, but make sure if you know that your program behaves normally, try out dash O3 and see if you can improve performance. This is basically literally three more letters you have to type when you compile the code, but it can make quite a lot of impact on the performance. So this is something I kind of want to make sure you are aware. One other example that are common in compilation technique is called inlining. We haven't talked about this technique, but basically when you call a function, what happened? Remember our assembly lecture, right? When you call a function, you have to create another stack and then do the push and then store the return address, right? So that when you have another function called, it's local to that function and you have the stack for that function. And everything on the stack is in DRAM. So after we learned the cache, the caching lecture, we kind of hate DRAM. DRAM is slow, right? Which means that when you call a function, you have to go to DRAM many times. What you can do is you can do inline function. In C code, you can do something like this. You can type in inline int, let's say the function add to number int A and int B. And in here you say return A plus B, right? Really simple function. It takes in two variable, add them together and return. If you actually put in the keyword inline in front of your function definition, what it does is if you have function F that call add, I don't know, X and Y, right? Here's function F, here's the function called add. Instead of these line calling add, you actually take the code in that add, plug it in function F. So that's why we call it inline. Instead of a function call, you put that whole function, the code inside there, inside the caller function. So inside F now we'll have the add function implemented. What's the benefit of this? You don't have to create another stack, right? There's no function call here. Now you basically run straight line code and inside F, there's a function to do the add. So you can turn on the optimization flag in GCC to perform this. It would detect like small function like this, add, multiply, like something that only have 5 lines of code. And it will put these function in line so that you don't have to create this a bunch of stack expansion. There's no function call anymore. So your code is faster. So quick lecture today, any question? By the way, next Thursday, we're gonna cover C++, so the lecture will be longer. Today, I want to make sure we clear up things like in class exercise 11 and 10, which have to do with caching and virtual memory. Okay, so I'm sure many of you are still trying to finish it up. I'm sure most of you still basically spend most of your time on assignment 3 so far, and you still basically save the in-class exercise for later. Let's do it today. Let's make sure we understand how caching works. Let's make sure we understand how virtual memory works. We can also discuss assignment 4, which is out now. You can take a quick look at that. What we will do on Thursday is on top of C++, I'm gonna cover how you would approach assignment 4. So that hopefully after the lecture on Thursday, you have some clue on, okay, what do I do in that function? What do I do in this function? Because if you know the steps, it's actually not complicated, but it looks daunting. It looks long. Once you know what you have to do, it's really, really follow the guideline and that's all. Okay, so I'm trying to make sure you know exactly what you have to do. Hopefully this allows you to have time to actually implement your code and make sure it's, basically make sure you can test it a little bit. And then if you test it and it's wrong, then you can come back to me sometime later next week and ask questions. Right. It's better to ask questions earlier than like ask questions on the last like 5 days of the assignment due date. All right, so there's another question from online folks. So when is the final exam? We have options. So on Sky, they put us on Tuesday, but I'm available both Tuesday and Thursday. So anyone prefer Thursday instead of Tuesday? So you prefer Thursday? I think, well, I'll put in the undergraduate student hat recall 10 years ago, me. I would also pick Thursday to have to delay things further. But some people might have conflict on that day. One thing I can do is I can have two versions of the exam for Tuesday and Thursday. That's also an option. I don't know which one, any preference here. So that's two votes for Thursday online. Anyone here vote for Tuesday? All right, no vote so far. Thursday, anyone prefer Thursday? No preference? Think about it, I'll ask again. All right, so basically that's it for the class. Please. So basically what we will do next is we go to Discord and do the like assignment 4 and in class 11. Please use that to your benefit. Basically ask me questions. All right, so let me stop the recording.